Happy Halloween, everyone. It is time for the last movie in our Halloween montage, as it were. We're about to watch The Halloween Tree.
So is there a good reason I'm dressed up as a skeleton?
Yes.
Alright.
There is a reason for everything I do.
That's what you say. Alright, so The Halloween Tree.
Yes. It is one of the, I would say, one of the most dark, enlightening, and educational Halloween kids movies you will ever see. The big thing about Halloween in many cultures, it's very different, correct?
Right.
But the main thing that they all have in common is death. It is the idea behind looking death in the eye and understanding it and not being afraid.
This sounds amazing.
It is. It's called The Halloween Tree because there is a tree filled with jack-o'-lanterns.
Yeah, that's not how jack-o'-lanterns grow.
It is not, but there is a reason for it.
Okay.
So the movie starts out where you see these four children who are getting ready for Halloween. They're putting on various costumes. There is a witch, a skeleton, a gargoyle, and a mummy.
Our costumes are starting to make sense now.
Yes, witch and skeleton. See, all of my things have reasons. Anyway, these children are all getting ready, and they're racing off to meet each other and their best friend, Pip.
Pip.
He is the best boy in the whole world, according to this movie. Oh my lord!
Some say that on the day he was born, all the soda pop bottles in the world fizzed over. Pipkin, who could yell louder, sing better, and eat more popcorn.
How is that even possible?
He's just like the cool friend.
Gotcha.
Think of the coolest friend you had as a kid, and it will be him.
What if you are the coolest kid you knew as a kid?
Then you are lonely. So they rush off to his house, and they see him being put into an ambulance.
Ooh, so Pip died. Or is this a prequel to the Halloween story where they show up and they find out that Pip is actually Michael Myers and he just murdered his family? That'd be a dark Halloween kid story, wouldn't it?
You're way too excited for that. You're adorable. Okay. Pip has appendicitis. So that he left a note on the door saying, something to do with appendicitis. You go ahead and trick or treat without me.
Oh, my body's just exploding from the inside. Let me, write a handwritten note to my friends.
They decide they don't want to go trick or treating because he's their best friend and, they don't want to have fun without him.
Right.
So they decide to take a shortcut to the hospital through the ravine.
Ravine?
The ravine.
No.
As Ray Bradbury calls it, the ravine.
The ravine was filled with varieties of darkness, night, shadows, toad eyes, and raven beaks.
Ray Bradbury?
Yes, he is the narrator and also the writer of this book.
So
it was a book before it was a movie.
Okay.
He probably didn't need to narrate.
I mean, yeah, if it's a good movie, you don't need a narrator. You can kind of get across visually how creepy the ravine is.
Well, as they're running through the ravine, they think they spot Pip. And they're like, oh, he was just pulling one of his classic Pipkin pranks.
Pip's dead. He died on the way to the hospital. They're chasing his ghost.
They are chasing a ghost, but he is not dead. He is not dead, though. So they follow Pip, and they come across this glorious Victorian home that looks like just the best place you and I would love to haunt. Just dark and opulent with bat weather vanes and dark balconies and all sorts of cool looking stuff. But the best part is, next to it, is the Halloween tree.
Oh, the Halloween tree?
The Halloween tree.
Oh my goodness. And this is what, this is filled with the pumpkins?
The jack-o'-lanterns.
The jack-o'-lanterns, yes. Excuse me, Halloween
yes.
tree.
Yes, because the man who lives in this building is Clavicle Moundshroud.
Clavicle, isn't that like a collarbone?
Yes. He's not human.
I would assume so with that name. That's not a name that's based in reality.
So these kids run up to the building, and Mount Shroud answers, and he's like,
"Who are you?"
Name's Tom Skelton.
Know why you're wearing bones, boy? Bah! Didn't think so. Why a monster's face, hmm? And what about you, girl? Why are you wearing a costume of a witch, hmm? All dressed up for All Hallows Eve, but you don't know why, or what, or even from where.
Do you know why you're dressed as a skeleton?
No, honestly.
And all of a sudden, Pip jumps out from behind something and runs out of the house, and they all run after him. And he runs to the tree, and he climbs up to his jack-o'-lantern, carved looking exactly like his face. Montroud yells, "You know, don't touch that pumpkin! That's my pumpkin!"
"But it has my face on it, sir."
"But it is his pumpkin."
"I guess."
You want to know something even creepier and kind of cool?
Okay.
He's voiced by Leonard Nimoy.
"But you may call me Mr. Mountrout."
That is amazing. Leonard Nimoy, like, everybody knows him from Star Trek, yeah, but he did do some fantastic voice work in his career.
Mm-hmm.
He was really good at it.
He does a really good job with this. He's literally pretty much the combination of Leonard Nimoy himself and the Crypt Keeper. So when Pip grabs his pumpkin, he shoots off into the sky, and they're like, "Where did he go?" And he's like, Montroud, aka Dr. Spook, is like, "In Halloween's past."
This is where it's gonna get educational, isn't
exactly.
it?
Exactly.
Gotcha.
So Montroud whips up his magic and tears posters off the nearby barn to make a gigantic kite. In order to stabilize the kite, the children all jump on to be the kite tail so that it can be controlled.
I don't think Ray Bradbury knows how planes work.
I don't think so, but let's just go with this as a magical, mystical Halloween movie.
Okay.
So they shoot off into Egypt.
So they take a kite 4,000 years into the past.
They do.
So Pip is, what, traveling into Halloween's past to
yes.
try and escape Mount Shroud?
Yes.
God, that's fun to say.
Isn't it Mount Shroud?
All right, so they're in Egypt.
They're in Egypt, and they have arrived on the day of the Feast of the Dead, where the spirits come out and families leave various food and offerings on their front porch so that the dead may enjoy and treat themselves, a.k.a. the first trick-or-treat.
Ooh, okay.
Yeah.
So the first trick-or-treat was for the spirits and not for the kids?
Exact among us. So basically, it's when they invite all of the old dead relatives out to enjoy a meal with them, even as far as in bringing out one of their dead grandfathers to a meal at their table, and it frightfully scares them.
That would scare me. What would you do for, like, the first 2 years? You're gonna have Grandpa's gooey corpse sitting there that smells worse than the Nile.
I'm gonna go with they probably didn't do that exact thing.
In my mind, like, I just don't see how they're literally bringing their dead relatives to the dinner table. But, like, I'm not an Egypt scientist.
Egyptologist.
A what?
Don't worry about it. So Pip happens to be in the house, and he gets spooked, and they chase after him into a temple. And unfortunately, because he is a soul, he also starts getting prepared for death. He is put in a sarcophagus. It has his face etched in it, and then they've got him holding, like, a bat and a ball and a glove or something like that. Kind of similar to how, like, you know, sarcophagus would be decorated.
I mean, they put some effort into this, it sounds like. It's pretty cool.
So since this is how, you know, a soul is put to rest in this culture, Pip starts to fade. And so the mummy kid runs in to scare the Egyptians who are doing that. I'm not sure why they got so scared, since they apparently invite their dead to dinner. But ignoring that fact, Pip manages to get knocked out of the sarcophagus, and he shoots off to the next location.
No thanks, just like, see you in the next 4,000 years? or 2,000 years, however long they're going to jump this time.
We have to learn about the entire history of Halloween in one night, Roman. We cannot dawdle just in Egypt. Into the realm of the witches.
So, did they go to, what, like Salem or something like that?
No, they go to Stonehenge.
Ooh, they're going deep.
They start there in the original Druid ancestry.
Okay.
So it starts with...
People thought that on this special night, those who had died during the year were turned into beasts, became animals.
So Pip transforms in Stonehenge into a black cat.
Now they have to chase a black cat around.
Yes, they do. And they chase him all the way to a broom festival. It's an ancient celebration, mainly involving harvest. And this is where you get to learn the truth about witches.
Ever wonder what the word witch really means? Witch! Nah! Information! In the Dark Ages, anyone with half a brain, any knowledge, had his wits about him, yes? So, anyone too smart was called...
A witch!
Exactly!
So, witch was really sort of a term given to somebody that was thought of to be as a very smart person?
Yes. It was out of fear that witches were destroyed. Back in darker times, people did not understand science.
Yeah. See, magic is really just science that people don't understand. Exactly. Essentially.
So Pip is also on a broom at this point, and he port keys with his pumpkin.
So, where are we now?
Obviously, it is time for the gargoyle.
Oh, the gargoyle.
And if we were going to speak of gargoyles, where do you think we would go?
Notre Dame.
Yes.
Classic.
We arrive at Notre Dame. They all try to run and find Pip. And they can't find him because the building is not complete. So Mountshroud, who surprisingly cannot enter...
He is a demon, isn't he?
No, he's not. He yells to them and he says...
So why not finish building the cathedral with your feet?
What kind of riddle is that?
Well, they're up on the edge of the stairway that is not finished yet. And as he says that, the girl gets the idea of what he means and shoves... the gargoyle kid, and he falls, but it's okay because the stone flies up and catches him, so it's like, you know, that's how you build it with your feet. You just keep running. One of the coolest scenes you will ever see, though, is as the kids are all running, stones are flying up around them and building itself, and it grows and grows, and it's so beautiful.
Sure. At this point, yeah.
So the boy whistles. And from the darkness, various demons, ghouls, and monsters come out, and they climb the cathedral. Lightning strikes, and they form various monster faces and gargoyles all over Notre Dame.
That's pretty rad.
Yes, it's beautifully dark and beautiful. I love it. Pip is now a gargoyle face in the wall.
What, they just, like, whack at his face until it chips off?
They yank the pumpkin out of his hands and it breaks him out of it.
Because he has to have his pumpkin.
Well, it's his soul. So they all jump on gargoyles to fly and chase after him, which is also incredibly cool looking.
So, what has this stop had to do with Halloween?
Gargoyles, I think, in this case, are representing all monsters.
Okay.
Yes.
So, just the monster aspect of it, and they just went with gargoyles? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can't think of anything better off the top of my head.
Exactly.
Comment below if you can think of anything better.
So now, last but certainly not least, my favorite celebration of Halloween... Dia de los Muertos.
Yes.
Day of the Dead. They get to go to Mexico for Day of the Dead.
Nice. Lots of life goals right there.
Yes. They actually comment on the fact that
back home we'd never think to go to a graveyard on Halloween, but this looks like fun.
Yeah, right.
And this was a kid was one of the things that got me really excited for the idea of like Dia de los Muertos and the idea of how death is considered just a part of life. And if you honor your ancestors for the lives that they had and the life you have because of them.
I feel like this is basically the moral to Coco, but in what, like a 10-15 minute segment?
Pretty much, in no musical numbers.
And with Leonard Nimoy.
Can't beat that.
No. Good luck, Disney.
So the gargoyles dump them off.
Oh yeah, they're still riding gargoyles.
They are. Nobody's noticed, though. So the gargoyles dump them off, and out of nowhere, this man carrying a huge branch with a bunch of skulls hanging from it says,
"Tell me your name, I give you your skull."
And they say their names, and he tosses them a skull, and he, you know, rips off his things, and it's Mound Shroud.
Oh, couldn't have guessed.
So Mound Shroud summons the different forms of the kids in pinata form, and then he himself turns into a pinata, and then out of nowhere, kids come over and beat Mound Shroud pinata until he turns into a giant swarm of bats that then picks up the children and carries them to the cemetery to a mausoleum.
Pinatas and bats, it's Halloween, right?
Sounds cool though, doesn't it?
It sounds amazing.
So they come to this mausoleum. It's like kind of a mass grave where they would put people whose family could not afford like regular graves. And so it's a place where they would just take the bodies and preserve them in this kind of like a catacombs.
Ooh, and the kids go into the catacombs?
Yes, the skeleton boy, the boy dressed as the skeleton Tom.
Right.
He has to go in and all of the dead corpses start to move.
Oh.
And the idea is that he has to look them in the eye without fear, as you have to look death in the eye without fear because it can't control you if you do. Pip is on the other side and he's starting to fade. He's once again in a place of where rest is and he's starting to fade. And his friend reaches him, but he disintegrates. And Mound Shroud has the pumpkin. And they're like, "That's not fair. We got to him first." And he's like, "This wasn't a game. This wasn't a race. This is how it was supposed to be."
So Pip's dead.
And this moment he is.
Wow, it does get dark for a kid's movie.
But here comes the dark yet somehow inspiring moment.
"No, wait. Mr. Mound Shroud, I'll make his payment for him. Yes, a year from the end of my life. It's yours if it would save Pip.
Take one of mine, too."
It's the moment that stuck with me since childhood when I first saw this movie. That in order to have him live, they give up 1 year from the end of their lives.
And Mound Shroud takes this deal?
He does.
He's still going to die a child, right?
I'm going to assume that this was just payment enough to have him live the rest of his destined life without the whole, you know, appendicitis thing.
So it's like, wait, you're going to go back knowing that one of your best friends only has 4 years to live? Like, you know the expiration date of your best friend. Do you tell his parents?
I think we're just going to go with the fact that his life is now extended past, like, he's going to live to be an old person. So Mound Shroud holds out a sugar skull that has Pip's name on it. He breaks it in 4 pieces, and they all take a bite.
That's how they've sealed the deal.
Exactly. And Pip reforms, grabs his pumpkin, and shoots off. And they're like, "Now where is he going?" And Mound Shroud's like, "Of course, where else would he go after all of this? Home!"
Yeah.
So Mound Shroud, like, whips up a storm, and they arrive back at the house, and Mound Shroud's like, "So that, my children, is Halloween."
4,000 years ago, 100 years, or this year, one place or another, the celebrations are all the same.
And they're like, you know, "Well, what happened? What happened to Pip?" And he's like, "Go find out."
At the hospital? Like, that's where they were trying to go to begin with.
They run to his house.
He was just taken away for an appendix bursting, what, six hours ago?
He is at the house.
So he is back home.
So they rush there, and he's at the window, and he's like, "It was like they took out my appendix. It was touch and go. They almost thought that I died there for a minute."
And they just let me walk out.
And he's just like, you know, "Thanks, guys." And they're like, "What? We didn't do anything." And he's just like,
"Well, I had dreams about pyramids, Stonehenge, Paris, and Mexico. Like I said, thanks."
So it's kind of like a shared moment.
And then all of them running off to their homes, apparently to go to bed and then think about their impending death. Like, will they die at 70 or will they die at 62?
Apparently, if Pip plays his cards right, he can outlive all of them.
He has to realize that he outlived all of them because they all gave up a year of their life for him.
The Green Mile.
Yes.
That's the ending of the Green Mile.
So as the first rays of sunlight and morning start to hit, Mountshroud blows out his own pumpkin. And with a flurry of wind and leaves, all of the jack-o'-lanterns fly out of the tree, and he himself vanishes, and it flies off into the sky.
So is that, like, 1,000 pumpkins? Is that, mm-hmm. like, all of the souls of people who have died on Halloween that night?
I don't know. It's unclear, but I would say maybe.
Creepy.
Very.
Is that the end?
That's the end.
I mean, I dig the whole, like, educational aspect of it, of going through, like, the history of Halloween and, like...
Through different cultures and time periods. Yeah, it's really cool.
Yeah, really explaining how, like, modern Halloween has become, like, a conglomeration of all these cultures mm-hmm. and traditions that have 4,000 years worth of history, at least, apparently.
It's really one of the only holidays that shares numerous aspects from different cultures and religions and, you know, time periods. Like, it's one of the
most inclusive holidays you'll find.
Pretty much.
This was kind of cool. I mean, I learned some about my heritage, right? For sure. This may end up being a movie that we have to watch every Halloween.
Even though you're learning about the history of Halloween, there's this impending thing about the soul of your friend.
It is a little heavy for a kid's movie. Just know your kid's, like, maturity level, I guess, before showing them this. Because the whole point of the movie is that they're trying to save the world's greatest kid from death.
Pretty much.
The whole, like, idea of Halloween is coming face-to-face with death. So having literally these kids in their youth confronting death head-on... Because their friend's dying. It honestly is sort of a great backdrop to this story of learning mm-hmm. about the meaning of Halloween. And what it is, how it is a celebration of life through death.
Exactly.
This movie may be a masterpiece.
It is. It is really a movie that people really should watch. And it is unfortunately put to the backdrops because people don't really want to deal with death with their children, which is understandable, but it's also the idea that life and death are yin and yang, essentially. You can't have one without the other. But it's also, you know, dark and spooky with a hint of you're gonna learn a little something. It's definitely better than showing your kids the spooky pumpkin for the umpteenth time. But this was a great way to spend Halloween.
It was a great way to spend Halloween. Yes. Happy Halloween again.
Yes, happy Halloween, everyone.
And we are continuing. Halloween just doesn't end here with October for us.
It does not.
November. We are continuing our spooky movie season.
Yes. Enjoy your Halloween. Stay safe and stay home. Eat some candy alone while watching cool Halloween movies like The Halloween Tree.
Yes.
Dress up like us because it's even fun when you're at home.
Yeah.
So happy Halloween, everyone. Toodles noodles.